Next up, the topic that we are going to talk about is, can an Indian beat a Kenyan? And to talk on this, we are privileged to have amongst us Mr. Adille Sumariwalla. Let's welcome him with a thunderous applause as our next chairperson. Mr. Sumariwalla is popular for representing India at the 1980 Moscow Olympics. A big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. He competed in a 100 meters. He competed as a 100 meter runner in several international competitions and at the Olympics. Currently, he's the president of the Athletics Federation of India. He had set the men's 200 meter intercollege record at a mere 22.2 seconds. Again, a big round of applause. This record remained unbroken for 35 long years. He has won the national title in 100 meter sprint 11 times. So the chairperson I present to you is Mr. Adille Sumariwalla. And we have two accomplished personalities sharing their, please sir. We have two very accomplished personalities sharing their views on the topic. I would like to call upon the first speaker, Mr. Daniel Vaz. Coach Daniel Vaz, Zico as he is called. Let's welcome Daniel Vaz. Daniel Vaz is one of the premier running coaches in Mumbai, having trained hundreds of Mumbaikers and successfully completing half and full. His trainees are completing successfully half and full marathons. He is the coach of Nike Run Club and the Colgate Palmolive Runners Club. He's working with Darjeeling Runners, that's the Roshni Rai Group. And a tremendous improvement is seen in these thanks to the efforts of Coach Daniel Vaz. As a runner, he has completed 27 full marathons, one ultra marathon of 50 kilometers, and several international marathons like Berlin, Switzerland, Istanbul, Turkey, Germany, just to name a few. I have had the privilege of conducting yoga sessions for his Nike Run Club, and he has given excellent tips to my trainees as well. So I am very proud to present to you the speaker, Coach Daniel Vaz. Over to you, Daniel.
Now, immediately.
The second speaker for this section is Coach Savio D’Souza. A big round of applause. May we have you on the dais, Coach Savio D’Souza. Again, a very accomplished runner, and was the national champion from 1984 to 88, 4 years in a row. Big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. And he, having him to talk on this topic is justified because he's the only Indian to have beaten a Tanzanian, Stephen Marwa, in the Pune International Marathon. Marwa had been the winner of the event the earlier year before Savio saw that his picnic was all over. He has been the recipient of Chhatrapati Shivaji Award for the most outstanding sportsperson in athletics by the Maharashtra government. He is working with the Ladakhi runners, and who have been stationed. They come 1 month in advance before the marathon. He trains them. And again, if you hear or read that they have done a fabulous job, you know whom to thank. So over to both of you all gentlemen, Mr. Savio D’Souza and Mr. Daniel Vaz.
Hello. Okay, in order to put things in perspective, perhaps it's important for us to understand whether there have been any basic studies about African runners. And from the few studies that were conducted, most, I would say significantly, by Toby Tanser, who wrote the book Train Hard, Win Easy, The Kenyan Way. A lot of it has been spoken about by Dr. Tim Noakes. What they have identified in terms of the parameters which have allowed African runners to dominate on the world marathon or endurance stage, I'll just enumerate a few of them, and then maybe with this perspective we can analyze as to what has happened in India and whether any runner can evolve out of that same perspective. They've understood that African runners, for one, have a characteristic in terms of being able to accumulate less heat when running at a high speed, and also to dissipate heat at that speed. So this is one significant thing which can cause your body's core temperature to rise and can compromise your pace, which distinguishes them from other runners who are white male or, you know, the female runners too. This particular characteristic they attribute to the fact that they are smaller in stature, less weight, and smaller height. Okay, that's one parameter which they've identified in terms of heat accumulation and heat dissipation. The other parameter that was identified in various tests that were done statistically also on these runners is that they have an ability to sustain fatigue for a longer period of time. Okay, and what they've stated is that the reason why this has happened is because they have two attributes in their muscular structure. Number one is, every time you land and propel yourself, you go through what is called as a stretch shortening cycle, which allows that plyometric ability to launch yourself forward. Now, in a marathon, this happens repeatedly, as you know. You know, the number of times the foot lands per minute into those 2 hours and 3 minutes or whatever. So that allows them a lot of fatigue resistance. This elasticity in their muscles is supposed to be more superior than any of the other white males all over the world. Okay, these attributes have also been known to be very specific to the East African continent, whether it's Kenya, Ethiopia, the Moroccans, Algerians, and the black Africans from South Africa. So that's number two. That is, the stretch shortening cycle and the fatigue in it is supposed to be sustainable for by them at sub-maximal speeds, which is really what happens in a marathon. You are running at sub-maximal capacity compared to your maximal capacity. Okay? Then the third thing that they've identified is that black African runners are able to store a lot more glycogen. You know, glycogen is the only material that can power the chemical compound that can power your run at higher speeds. The more glycogen you have, the better chance you have of sustaining the 42 kilometer distance. We all know that even the Kenyans and the Ethiopians encounter the wall. But the wall for them somehow is pushed a lot towards the finish line because of this ability to be able to have a lot more glycogen storage in their leg muscles. Not only that, the exhaustion of this glycogen content or whatever quantity that they have stored, the rate at which it is consumed is found to be much lower than any of the other runners, which is why perhaps when you look at the statistical map of marathon times and world records, the dominance of black African runners, or most specifically from East Africa, is, you know, undisputed. So these are a few attributes of the African runners which I'd like to present to you in that perspective in this discussion, and maybe two or three observations which I have when we look at coming back to the topic as what happens in India. If you look at Shivnath Singh's record set in 1978 in Jalandhar, it's 2 hours 12 minutes, right? 38 years later, it's still not broken. Okay, so what is it that perhaps we are lacking as a nation, that in 38 years, whether that was just a small genetic anomaly that took place in the late 70s. Of course, he also competed in Montreal in Canada and clocked 2:16. So that's, let's say, even a more believable time in terms of the fact that it was internationally determined. But 2:16 then and 2010, we have 2:16 from Ram Singh Yadav. So there is no improvement over those years. So I personally feel that the whole thing can be attributed to the fact that as a nation, we do not have, let's say, even if the genetic potential exists, which we don't know, and that's debatable, and that's what we are talking about now, we do not have the kind of training camps that the Africans have. We all know that, about the Kenyan training camps and how their selection procedure is so rigorous that it can filter out some of really the best runners. A couple of Swedes in the mid-1990s had gone to Kenya, and they found that they couldn't hold their own against high school runners running a 10K because they were all doing almost 30, 31 minute 10Ks. You know, so that's the kind of genetic potential which they managed to even empower all these runners, put them in training camps. And mind you, these runners in the Kenyan training camps, as Toby Tanser describes it, they do nothing other than running. Their sole objective is to improve their running. And of course, they have training schedules, and there are training schedules which almost every other runner in the world is exposed to. But I do not think that it's the quality of their training or even the quantity which would determine and bring them out on the map in such a prominent way. But it is the fact that they train their runners in a focused way. The runner has to do nothing else other than focus on running in these training camps. So perhaps if we were to identify certain segments, like Savio works with Ladakhi runners, and I've worked with the Darjeeling runners. Now, these runners, if you really look at them, they are raw potential, uncut diamonds. Okay? Many of them I've seen, possibly tomorrow, I do not know about Savio's runners, and I would like to share with you that many of them tomorrow are likely to be touching 112, 113. And this is not based on training. This is their inherent potential that is coming out. I'm not saying that it's attributable to the fact that they've been trained by me, but it is a potential which is 112 for a 19 to 22-year-old guy coming and turning up in the Mumbai Marathon. So what perhaps could be done is, if these runners were identified and were put in similar kind of camps, I'm saying we do not have them, but as a nation, if we were to want to identify whether we can compete with the Kenyans, this is the only way that you find this segment and put them in these camps and train them on a year-on-year basis with periodization. You know, the Kenyans have camps from October to February, and then they have a period of layoff, and again they come back into the camps. So I feel that, yes, there might be a potential when you look at the fact that raw runners are producing 112 times in a half marathon. Yes, there can be a potential, but they need to be trained. That's just my submission to you. Thank you.
Savio, can you give us some of your experiences, please?
Hi. And all the best for you for tomorrow. We'll be running together. I have been training these Ladakhis. I went to Ladakh in the month of July. When I went there, I found that they did not even have an athletic ground, like the 400-meter track. One school, they had a track, but it was very, very sandy. So basically, they just run on the road. There was no formal coaching. They don't even have a single coach to tell them what to do and how to run. They were totally raw. So when I went there for only 2 weeks because I could not give more of my time. So there I set a program for them and all those things a little bit. Only the basics, only the mileage. So I had to put them on that endurance, like, you know, how to build up the endurance. Little bit of speed. I could not give them too much of speed because I did not know the actual base, how well they were this. But another thing what they were lacking is, in spite of that, the interval trainings and the track workout, they did not know how to run a race because they just run. They don't have any experience because there are no races happening there. Only race there, which takes place there, is the Ladakh Marathon, which happens in the month of September. And the organizer of the marathon, Mr. Motu, He sponsors them, the winners, the first three in that ultra marathon, the 42 and the 21. He brings them to Bombay, and then they take part in the Bombay marathon. So these are the only two races. So there is no experience. Like there was one girl who ran last year, and she ran the 42 kilometers. She was 21. This year she's 22 years. She clocked a timing of 3 hours 41 minutes. So when I saw her certificate, first thing I said, let me see what was her timing. The breakup I saw, the first 21 she ran in 1 hour 38 minutes. And that means the overall timing. She was slow by half an hour. That means she ran the first half very fast. Only if she could have run slightly faster, like 3 minutes slower, I mean, in the first half, or 5 minutes slower, she would have almost come to 3 and a half hours. That means that is the potential they have. Or she could have done still better. Even 3 hours 20 she could have done. And there's another girl also with her. They're both very, very good. In fact, I feel that there is a lot of talent, and if they are picked up and put into this Indian camps, in the Indian training camps, they will do very well because they are really very interested. And even after the marathon, I asked them, like, do you all want to go back after the Bombay marathon? Because there it is snowing now. It is, I think, minus 12. So I said, there is another race in Thane in the month of February. They said, no, we would like to stay here, train here, and run the Thane Marathon. That means they are hungry. They want to run. They want to do well. And coming to this, whether the Indians can defeat the Kenyans or the Tanzanians. Now, we have this lady athletes. Some of them have defeated, I think, the Kenyans or the Ethiopians in Delhi in the 21. They came. They might have not stood first, second, third. But they were there in the first 10. And they have improved a lot. They have qualified for the Olympics. No. So that means we are coming in, and they are coached by a Ukrainian coach. Their base is in Uti. And that coach, mind you, is very, very strict. Adil knows about him. They have this fight every time, the misunderstanding between the coach and the AFI. Because he does not allow them to even go and run the railway meet. They are working for the railways. Because he is concentrating on the Olympics. He wants the Olympic event. You know, that is how it has to be. You cannot send the athletes to train from meet to meet. It has to be a long-term process. And if these children from Darjeeling, from Mizoram, from Ladakh, if this raw talent is picked up, it is tapped and is picked up, and put them in the training section, you know, in the long-term, like 4 years, 8 years, then that is the only time you'll get results, and they might be able to defeat the Kenyans also. Now these Ladakhis, they are staying at 10,000 feet above sea level. 10,000 feet and 14,000 feet, they are born at that level. Their lung capacity is huge. They are physically very strong because everything is walking for them. They either have to walk and run and all those things just like the Kenyans. So physically, they are very strong. But the only thing, there is no coach to guide them. There is no other training facilities for them. There are no meets. Now, these athletes from Ladakh, they are in the age of 18, 19, 20. I think the oldest is around 22 or 26. Some of the Ladakh scouts, they are in the 26, I think. There are no track events. There are no 10,000-meter races. So how are they going to do their speed workout? There are no other races happening over there. And they cannot come on this side of the town every time, like, you know, to Delhi is closer, but every time they have to fly. There are no roads where they can come. So if this talent is tapped, I think they are capable, they can defeat this Kenyans and Africans because of their ability. For us city people, we on the big side, we don't even walk. How will we run? We use the cars every time. When we are not ready to walk, how will we run? Another thing, the Kenyans, which are the Kenyans or the Ethiopians who are winning, are not the rich one who has the money, the one who does not have anything to eat. They are hungry. They know that this is the only way they can come up in life. This is the only way they can earn some money. So that is what it is. If you see our athletes from Kerala and all the other places, who are the ones? The ones who are very, very hungry. They want to win the nationals is because so that they can get a job. So that is what it is. Now our children, now I have been running. My children have not taken up for running. Adil's children have not taken up for running. Why? Because they are getting everything ready-made. They don't have to work that hard. So this is what it is. We'll have to go in the interior and tap the talent over there. They are the children who are the hungry ones. They are the ones who will be ready to work hard. Because anyhow, they are working hard every day. So they know what is hard work. So that is what it is. That is where the talent is. And that is where we have to find out the talent. Okay, this is all what I wanted to say. And all the best to you. Thank you.
Mr. Adil, would you like to interact and ask them some questions, please?
I want to say a couple of things first.
Please do.
Being the president of the Athletics Federation of India, people keep asking you this question. If the Kenyans can do it, if the Africans can do it, why can't we? And the answer to that is not simple. And especially more difficult for me because I'm a sprinter, I understand nothing about middle and long distance running. So I try to do some research, talk to people who understand this a little more. And I want to add to a couple of things both these coaches have said because they work with the athletes. He's right. There has been enough research and more. One of the research which says very clearly done by Danish researchers who stayed 18 months in Africa and researched with taking one kid from Denmark, one kid from Kenya, and one kid from the Great Rift Valley, where the Kalenjin tribe is. And these are the Kalenjin tribe has won 40% of the middle and long distance races in the world. 40%, just one tribe. And after training them identically for a period of 3 months, they put them to a 10-kilometer race. They had equal timings before they started, and the Kalenjin kid beat all of them by a distance. Now, one of the things, as he said, they dissipate heat very fast. Some of the things that these tribe people have is very, very low heart rates. Even while running, if we start running, our heart rate jumps up very fast. There doesn't come up that fast. So it's very, very slow. The second thing that they have is their research shows they have bird-like legs that allow them to bounce and skip on the ground. Something similar to, or this is the actual research report which says that. The other research report says that they all tend to have long, thin limbs that cool easily, even in hot and dry climate. So when it's hot and dry, these Kenyans are still running and running and running, where the others start fading out. They have slender calves, thin ankles that greatly aid in running efficiencies, and they produce more red blood cells using oxygen more efficiently. Something similar to what he said. And one of the people who lived there, he was a Britisher, David Espetin. He was the guy who's actually the father of this Kenyan running. He started with the first big one was Kipkino, and it's all come down from him. So, but Lord Sepko, who's now the president of the Athletics Federation, everybody knows Lord Sebastian Coe, he says, no, that's not true. He doesn't believe that genetics plays that important a role. He says, yes, it plays some role, but not that important a role. And he argues that socioeconomic factors and environmental conditions, play a significant part
in making of the athlete. And he says, unless you, these factors are separated, no study can be reliable unless you isolate the genetics from the environment and the socio-economic problems, issues that you have. And he goes on to say that the socio-economic conditions, again, something what Savio said, he says socio-economic conditions require the Kalenjin youth to run upward of 10 miles each day, even to school and back. And at an altitude of 7,000 plus feet, and the bigger, they have nothing. They are the poorest of poor. And financial impact of winning races for them is very, very big. And to that is supported by medical evidence on the role of the environment in disease that supports cause proposition. And it explains that Japanese enjoy low rate of strokes, breast cancer. However, Japanese immigrants in the US suffer far more strokes and cancer, etc., etc. So there is some relation to say that the environment plays a very, very important role. And yeah, the other thing where environment plays a very important role, and I'll come to sprinters because I'm a sprinter, and over the last 7 years, seven Olympics, men's 100 meter race, for example, all 56 finalists have been from Western, the middle and long distance runners come from the Eastern. This is from Western African descent. They all come from different countries. They've all migrated to, say, Jamaica, Trinidad, Tobago, wherever, USA, Canada. But there is not a single sprinter who was born and who trained in Western Africa who is in this list. This again goes to support the environment that we are talking about. So, having said that, I think it's a combination of some sort of genes, this combination of environment that they're running at X thousand feet. I think it's socio-economic, and it's a combination of all. You know, we keep saying if we picked up these athletes young and if we kept training them, they would win, etc., etc., etc. I think the other very big problem is, we are a country far more democratic. We are a country that, we are like that only types. I don't think that we are a country as a whole to say that this is a one-point agenda and we are going to do it. And he spoke about Nikolai Koch. Nikolai Koch started with around 20-odd athletes. Today he's left with 3. He's a madman. He's a tyrant. He's abusive. He is, you can use all the negative aspects. He literally, to the point of tortures the athletes, they're getting some performance. Also, it's not right to say that we really don't have the Army Training School in Pune is, I think, doing a good job of training. They have a fantastic scientific center. But then again, it comes down to the coaches. In India, I'm sorry to say, but we don't have coaches with enough technical expertise. I don't know if some of our coaches who passed NIS can even describe what Daniel said. And I don't think he's a qualified coach. Ah, you know. Yes, you are. Okay. You're luckily you are. But one of the few who are. But I'm sorry to say that they have no concept of science because a lot of them have no science background. To me, sports is science. And athletes are robots of sports science and sports medicine. I mean, I was fascinated when I heard the doctor speak about the shoe. I mean, I was absolutely fascinated. When I was running, we had we had Bata shoes on which we put that Blanco and, you know, those white color Blanco shoes. We had no shoes. So, I mean, this sort of, so the amount science has advanced, the amount science has advanced is incredible. And sadly so, our coaches are not up to mark. They're just not, I mean, a lot of them can't even read or write a word of English. I'm nothing wrong with that. But the fact remains that most of the literature is in English. So that's a problem. And they don't want to upgrade themselves. So I think we have the basic talent. I think there are enough socio-economic factors. And actually sometimes it becomes negative. Because our marathon runners want to run every second week. Where I was talking to the president of the World Marathon Association, and he told me, Adil, no top marathoner runs more than 3 marathons a year. Really strong, good marathon. You see all our guys running for money. Again, it's a socio-economic problem. Now, when we want to bring, and I think something that standards that Venkat may be talking about later, when we are trying to say that a marathoner will not run more than X number of marathons, everybody is up in arms. We are trying to protect the athlete. The media is saying you are against the athlete. Or if the athlete is getting burnt out and dying. And that is why we are not able to produce, as we rightly said, we can't produce a 216 runner today. And that 216 runner goes to the Olympics and runs how much? 220?
Almost 230.
230. Yeah. 228, 230. He runs 230. Why? Has anybody analyzed? But the Athletic Federation is bad. So, because you want to run for money. You'd want to run every small race, either 50,000 mil gaya, lakh rupiah. Yes, they need the money. I'm not saying no. Then they will complain they have no shoes to run. Whereas government of India gives every athlete as many pairs of shoes, especially the middle and long distance runner. All they have to do is produce a bill. But they won't say that. They probably produced a fake bill and taken the money. That they're not telling the people. So we have to work together. The athlete also has to understand, because the athlete today feels, and it's their coaches, it's not the athletes. Their coaches are taking a percentage of that money, which they all know. When the athlete wins, the coaches takes a percentage of the money. So I'm trying to make you people understand there is a huge socio-economic issue in this country. And we are not a dictatorship. Because if we are, I would have slaughtered a lot of these guys by now. But we are not. And I can't do it. And how many guys am I going to throw out? Then I'll have no coaches left. So, you know, please understand that these are very serious, you know, interlinked problems. So, but I still believe we have a talent. I'm not saying that we can get a medal in the Olympics in the marathon immediately, but I think faster in the 5,000, the 10,000, the 1,500, I definitely believe that we have the body structure, we have what it takes to be a medalist at the Olympics, and I really hope that we do. Thank you. And if there are any questions, I'll answer them.
Simon, you have a question? Adil, Savio and Danny, I appreciate that you all spoke very bare truth of athletes. But now, as you very clearly said, because of hungry, we do all the sports and all, we get job, then we give up the sports. Now, how do we develop passion for these marathon runners? Of late, I found that a lot of these recreational runners, where Mumbai Chartered Marathon has bought, and a lot of lay people are so passionate about running, it is something great, which we never had in our time. People are just interested in job, as you clearly said. Okay, how do we motivate these people? And I think most of our Indian athletes, they need a proper guidance and good motivational so that they become a passion of their life and then their improvement will automatically come.
So what is the question?
Question is how to improve their timing and...
No, timing in distance running, there is no substitute to hard work. There is absolutely no substitute to hard work. In sprints, you could still manage sometimes if you're very highly talented and the training is not sufficient. But in middle and long distance, it's just miles and miles and miles that one has to put in. There is no other substitute for that. And again, scientifically, whether you want to train on altitude, you know, there is a time when we are fighting with Coach Nikolai because he says, if the event is on so-and-so date, I will come down from altitude after 1 o'clock on so-and-so date. But there is no flight after that. No, then I will come and stay in Coimbatore, but I will only come back on sea level only after so-and-so time. Now, that is the sort of scientific work that goes into it. So if you see, there are two different things. Passion is from within. Passion, nobody can do anything to passion. I think passion comes from within, point number one. Point number two, there's no substitute of hard work. Three, we are not a sporting culture. We don't have sporting culture nation. So it will take time when there will be events. I'll tell you what will happen if we have one or two champions. For example, when PT Usha happened, half of Kerala started running. And a quarter of the country started running. So we need big names and we need champions. And when this happens, automatically things will change. Today, the Kenyans have so much to look up to that there are so many champions. So unless that happens, we are not, everybody wants a kid to become a doctor or an engineer or whatever. Nobody says take sports as a career. And sometimes I think rightly so. But today times have changed. Today there are sports management courses. If you took up sport, you gave up sport, you could still do something in sport. There are all these leagues. There are enough job opportunities available today, which did not exist, say, 5 years ago or 7 years ago. So it's what you want to do. And if you have enough passion, I think you'll do it.
Thank you.
Okay, last question.
Dr. Sumariwala, you said that there were no coaches or you were finding it hard to find good coaches. Now, there is a lot of work happening. There is a poster over here from the ESA, one of the affiliates of ACSM. And there may be many more coming into India. So there are courses happening, there are a lot of workshops happening, there are a lot of laymen have passion, they want to give it back to the community. How can one join as a coach with you?
For us, first of all, if you've trained an athlete, like most of these people have done, if you've trained an athlete who's done well, or relatively already come into the reckoning. So if you are working with X number of athletes, you come into the reckoning. Now the question is, I will ask you to come into camp. How many can Savio leave home and come into camp? No, he will not come into camp. Will Daniel come? He will not come into camp.
Got it.
So, see, I'm saying these are very complex issues. It's not as simple as one makes it out. Oh, we have talent. Why can't we produce a world champion? No, because the good coaches will say we are working outside. But if the coach can get us a medal, fine. PT Usha is working with her athletes. We have allowed her to work with her athletes. So that's the sort of thing that continuously happens. Now, when we ask you to come to camp, because you cannot train one middle distance runner. You'll need a team of middle distance runners. If you're a good coach, we want your help. We need you to be in camp to train others. But you refuse to come to camp because you have another job or another commitment somewhere. So these are very complex issues which one must understand.
So is there an eligibility criteria which is already spelled out?
There is no eligibility criteria per se. We continuously run IAAF courses for coaches. We try and scout for them there. We scout with the state associations. Every state association is supposed to give us a chief coach. That means the 30 odd chief coaches of state associations, we try to source from them. We have a seminar for them every year, the coaches seminar. In that, we try to source, are there coaches in your region who are doing good work? Would they like to come into the national camp? We would like to bring them with their athletes to the national camp.
So is there a website or anything?
No, it's the Athletic Federation website. That's just a basic athletic federation website, but you can post what you want on it and you'll get a reply. The chief coach is on it who answers questions on the website. You can actually talk to the chief coach on the website. And now we have a high performance director for the first time, a guy called Derek Boosie from the US. He himself represented UK at the 68 Olympics in long and triple jump. His father was an Olympian and he was born in India. So we brought him down as a high performance director. So we are doing whatever we can in our own way. Costs a lot of money. These things don't come cheap. Understand, athletics has 47 events. Marathon is not the only event that we are looking at. Marathon is the 47th event. There are 46 events before that. And for each event, it's not like hockey or football. You need two or three people as a coach, a manager. Here for each event, the sprints will be 100-200. The 100-200 coach does not coach 400. Then again, it's men and women. Then you have a 8-1500. There's a hurdles coach. There's a jumps coach. The high jump coach is different from a long and triple coach. The javelin coach is different from a discus coach, who is different from a shot putt coach, who discus from a javelin. So it's a very complex thing, athletics. And that many more people are required, and that much more money needs to be spent. Now money is again not an infinite number. You have X amount. So you have to play within all of that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Adille Sumariwalla. Thank you very much, Dan. Thank you, Savio, for coming and making this possible. Before I let the gentlemen get off the stage, I have a small request of them to release two books. One, last year we released the Sofa to 5K book. And, we believe that running should not be just a South Bombay phenomenon. Running should not be Marine Drive to Chowpatty and back. But if you want talent to come up, talent has to come up from the grassroots level, and not necessarily all those people who have talent speak English. So we have gone into a program where we are translating and releasing the same book, which is a very basic how to start running 5 kilometers book. Nothing scientific about it, makes it fun, makes it joyous. Not necessarily targeted at the young athlete, but more at a middle-aged person to, public health kind of issue. And we are very happy that, we have the translator of the Tamil edition. So we translated the book into the Tamil edition and the Telugu edition. And we have the translator of the Tamil edition, Mrs. Lakshmi Vishwanathan, here with us. She is the mother of Viji Swaminathan. And many people who are from Chennai or know dream runners in Chennai will know Viji Swaminathan, because she, her husband, Satyamurthy Swaminathan, and her two daughters are all, dream runners family. They kind of started a revolution in, dream runners in Besant Nagar, where, what was two or four people has now become a 4,000 people event. So in about 5 or 6 years. So we are very happy to have it. And I would request Mr. Adille Sumariwalla to release the Tamil edition of the book. Come. Mrs. Lakshmi Vishwanathan is a renowned author by herself, and for her, it was a labor of love. I really know how much effort has gone into translation, because you have to be technically correct, at the same time you have to make sense to a common person. Thank you very much. Thank you.
இது நான் ரெண்டு என்னோட நீ ரீப்ளேஸ்மெண்ட்க்கு அப்புறமா எழுதினது இது. இது ஒரு நீ ரீப்ளேஸ்மெண்ட்க்கு அப்புறம் 5 கிலோமீட்டர் நான் பிங்கத்தானுக்கு நடந்தேன். அப்புறம் இது இது ஃபுல்லும் தமிழில் டிரான்ஸ்லேட் பண்ணும்போது இது ஒரு பேஷனோடு பண்ணிருக்கேன். இது எனக்கு கொடுத்த ஒரு வெங்கட் கொடுத்த ஒரு ரொம்ப வாய்ப்பாக நல்ல வாய்ப்பாக நினச்சிட்டு தேங்க் பண்ணுறேன்.
தேங்க் யூ. Well, let me translate. She said that she's had both her knees replaced, and after having the knee replacement, she read the book. and then she took part in a 5-kilometer walk. And the book was inspiring to her, and she's thanking me for the opportunity to have given her the opportunity to translate the book into this. The Telugu edition, I would like Padmaja Shastri, because is she here? Padmaja, are you here? Okay, I think she stepped out. I would like Mr. Adille Sumariwalla to also release the Telugu edition of the book. I must also mention here that both these books have been adopted by running groups. The Telugu edition has been adopted by Hyderabad Runners, and Rajesh Vecha was supposed to be here, but he has texted me that, you know, he cannot make it. And we have priced it very, very reasonably at just 100 rupees, though it's a high quality job. And the purpose of the book again is that running must grow in the interior of the country. Those who were there for the morning keynote speech know from that, who is the, you know, CEO of the Great Run Company, that running can really grow in our country. You know, 1 million runners take part in a recreational run every weekend in the UK. 1 million. 10 lakh people run one run or the other. And we don't have even 2 lakh runners all over the country running various weekends. So, you know, there's a huge potential, and that potential cannot come only from the English-speaking population. Talent has to come from the interior of the country, and that population doesn't speak English. Sure.
Actually, there was one point I forgot to make, was that if you look at our runners, if you look at all our top runners, they mostly come from rural areas, from very humble background. And when Savio and I used to be running, we used to be on the same team. We used to run 100 meters to marathon. But in those days, say for example, the Maharashtra team was 70% Mumbai. The rest of 15% came from Pune, Thane, Nasik. And 5% came from the rest of Maharashtra. Today, that's completely reversed. And I want to tell you, 80% of our team come from rural areas. And that is where the talent is. Yeah, so thank you. Thank you, Venkat. For giving us this opportunity, and I'm very humbled. I know nothing about middle and long distance running, but I tried to make an attempt, and thank you very much.
Thank you. We move on to the last session, which is an event organizers forum, and I would request Mr. Subbu Anantharaman, Nikhil Shah, and Sahil Amit, Sahul, please come up. Subbu, come. Sorry. My apologies. I did not.
Come, 1 minute. Sir, I want you there. I want you there for the last event.
Oh, you want me?
Yeah.
Okay.
A small token of our appreciation to Daniel Vaz. Thank you.